morning. Wow, thank you for your response. I'm Haslinda, Amin from Bloomberg Television. There's been a paradigm shift. I love this crowd already, thank you. There's been a paradigm shift, a rebalancing of the global economy, the world increasingly looking to the East, and some say that this decade belongs to emerging markets. But wait, China is slowing. That's a prolonged commodities rout. There's expectation of higher rates in the US, and global trade is pretty muted at best. And this is all happening as we stand on the brink of a fourth industrial revolution. Technology is developing so rapidly that even developed countries are finding it hard to catch up. We talk about driverless cars, medical imaging, drones, delivering your letter. We talk about the Internet of Things. I know some of you are saying, I've heard that before, but what does it really mean? Whether or not Southeast Asia propels itself, grows at the rate it wants to, depends on how it embraces these factors, the new reality. Can it? Will it? How can it do it? Well, it gives me great pleasure in introducing our panelists today, a very, by the way, distinguished panel of speakers. And I was told there's no way I can control this panel. Please join me in welcoming Nazir Razak, CIMB Chairman. Mari Pangestu, former Indonesia Minister for Trade, also Minister for Tourism and Creative Economy. I got that right, Ibu?
Yes.
Yoshiaki Fujimori, LIXIL Group President and CEO. Ewaldsson, Ericsson Senior VP and Chief Technology Officer. And Shahril, Shamsuddin, President and CEO of SapuraKencana Petroleum. Ibu Mari, gentlemen, I want to start off by asking you, so many challenges being faced by Southeast Asia. What is the key factor, the key challenge that will decide the prospects for growth for this region? Is it a slowing China? Is it technological change? Let's start with Shahril. Your take on that.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me here. First, I think we need to put the activities into context of time. You mentioned just now, everything is slowing, but the swings in economy and the cycles have always been there since the beginning of time. So really, when things like this happen, it's time, it's actually an opportunity. And what ASEAN have going for it is its population, its young population, that is going to be able to adapt to the fourth industrial revolution that you spoke of. It is also fortunate that being a new region, you have the ability of implementing new systems without having to worry about legacies infrastructure that has been put in before. So I guess in the end of it, as an economic zone, we have to decide what it is that we can be good at working together. I think this is important because we all have relative strength. And it is up to the ASEAN people to decide and to motivate their governments to collaborate. I think all too many times we always focus on criticizing policies. But at the end of it, I think it's people that moves things. And in this context, I think it's imperative that business takes the lead to capitalize on this very young population that's going to embrace these new technologies. Just one more thing that I would like to mention. You talked about the changing face of industry. You talk about automation, robotics, and all this. This in itself spawns a whole new supporting industry around it. So what's key for ASEAN is to recognize this new paradigm on where and how to train its people to move up the value chain to subscribe to this new paradigm of supporting industries that would emerge as the fourth industrial revolution comes into place.
Ulf, Shahril talks about time. It takes time. Do we have the luxury of time? I mean, ASEAN is known for moving slowly, slowly. You take a look at the Middle East. I mean, when it comes to IT investment, this year alone, they're putting in, pumping in more than $200 billion. Where is ASEAN in this in comparison?
Well, I think, I mean, if you look at technology, there is no slowdown, which is perhaps the optimistic view of it. Then the investment community is of course, extremely significant for technology development. But I would say that in terms of, I don't know if this is working.
Can we just ensure?
I think, look at the transforming factors that are affecting the rest of the world. What we talk about in technology in terms of mobility, the broadband, and the cloud, and how those technologies are transforming business, people, and society, we can see that ASEAN is certainly not any descriptors into that. We have one of the strongest demographic situations here, very young and what we call digital native online consumers, etc. We also have one of the fastest adoption rates of smartphones in the world. We have around 300 million smartphones in Southeast Asia today, and that is growing to a number of more than 900 million, three times in the next 5 years. We have a traffic growth in terms of what they use these devices for, from a 1 gigabyte of consumption or approximately per user, growing up to nine times that in just the next 4 to 5 years. So there are no significant indicators of any slowdown or any issues on that side. And I think that if you look at the key questions for business here is Southeast Asia going to just follow the development, or is, for example, cloud and digital transformation going to be led by here, using these young demographics, using the opportunities that are here for online shopping, etc., is that really going to be just led or drive it?
Phenomenal rate of adoption, but let's be clear, it is from a very low starting point. And Ibu Mari, ASEAN is also known for working in silos. I mean, it's great in principle to be talking about, you know, moving together, collaborating, but ASEAN tends to work in silos. Yeah. Not to put you on the spot or anything.
Yeah, I think we have to move forward and meet the challenges. I think the short-term challenge is very clear. It's the slowdown in China. It's the whole change in the way we do trade and business. The notion of production network and value chain has changed totally. That needs you not to work in silos anymore, because you're talking about clusters of activities, which means that it's good services and all the things that have to go to facilitate businesses to work together. And that requires you not to look at trade in goods, trade in services, because they're interrelated, right? So I think the challenge for each of our countries, and then therefore ASEAN, is really how to restructure our economies and find new sources of growth, because we are in this secular stagnation of the global economy. And if we need to increase our productivity, we need to diversify our economies, like the commodity producers like Indonesia. So how do we do our structural reforms? It has to be informed by also the regional agreements, such as ASEAN, you know, in my view. And here is where you were asking about the silos. We are still, if you like, the regulators and the policymakers are still in the old world, whereas the world is now already in the new world, where everything is integrated and interdependent. And we have the tendency to over-regulate and control and actually kill some of the innovative ideas. Of course, we have to regulate, but we have to do it in a way which is in line with the new economy and the new world. And that requires us not to work in silos. How should we do it? We need to, you know, the ASEAN Economic Community is one platform. And we should not be looking at goods, services, investment, movement of people. You should look at it holistically. If you want to be competitive, productive, innovative, creative, you need to be open to goods flowing, investment coming in various sectors. Services is an integral part of you being competitive in all this, whether it's logistics, whether it's the broadband, whether it's the telecom. And finally, talent, movement of talent, which is normally a very sensitive issue. So we have in our vision, movement of professionals as part of the ASEAN Economic Community vision. We have all these MRAs, but I don't think we are very far in terms of making that really happen. But I think, you know, we go from pooling of resources, pooling the market. We haven't gone to that point of pooling our talent to be able to be competitive and productive and creative and innovative as ASEAN.
In your perspective, Nazir, this restructuring of the economy, how far are we? How far do we have to go now? I mean, we've been talking about the restructuring, we talk about the AECD, ASEAN Economic Community, this single market. What have we achieved?
Well, I think insofar as the AEC is concerned, it certainly wasn't what ASEAN promised us in 2007. But nevertheless, a great deal has been achieved. We have announced the new blueprint for 2025. And, you know, in some ways, you could also argue that going at the right pace is more important than, you know, getting there, certainly more effective than getting there too soon, as is currently lively debated in Europe. Right? So we've got to get the right integration formula for ASEAN. But if I could, I think the way I look at it, the bigger question is this, that ASEAN has every reason to be optimistic about its future. Demographics was talked about, our endowment of natural resources, etc. But four critical factors, in my view. One is, you know, execution. Will we execute in ASEAN as a whole, but also in each country? And what are the challenges to executing the right policies? What will the political challenge be also? We see various ASEAN countries currently in sort of under some stress in terms of their political systems. Two is, how do we embrace this fourth industrial revolution that you talked about? Embracing it means also taking on the challenge of developing entrepreneurs, disruptive technologies, and allowing them to challenge vested interests. And vested interests in this part of the region is very, very strong. The link between big corporations and governments are very, very strong. So that's quite a big challenge for ASEAN. The third challenge is, I think, geopolitics as a whole, how that's evolving. There certainly is a challenge or a pushback on against the establishment. You see this in the US, Europe, etc. So there's a risk of protectionism. There's also a lot of potential flashpoints in geopolitics today. And the fourth challenge, in my view, is global reform. I think, you know, 8-9 years down from the global financial crisis, it's becoming very clear that it wasn't just the nasty bankers the crisis.
No, it's not.
It's a little bit more than that. And I think, you know, people are questioning the system. And the system that has given us too much debt today. And how do we restructure? What will that restructuring require? And those changes, how will it affect the region? How does the region deal with it?
And Fuji, your take on it, in terms of prospects for ASEAN, the biggest risk?
No, I think it's risk and opportunities always. We see this market is potentially a huge market. As a matter of fact, we have 12 factories in this region. We have 14,000 people over here. And that's great news. But on the other side, we see this region is not one ASEAN. This is 10 countries still, because we have different standards, different regulations, different currency, of course, different languages. Each country acts as totally different. Now, we formed AEC, but it's still a start. It's still young. They're trying to be more integrated. They're trying to be more a part of the growth as the region. But there are a lot of challenges, I think, that this region has to make in terms of creating one ASEAN. I'm not sure the EU is the model, or at least that we need to have one ASEAN where the people get collaborate each other and create an integrated and inclusive one region. And that is the way that we participate and we put more investment in this region. The fourth industrial revolution that we're talking about is the word by those who experienced second and third industrial revolution. Now, ASEAN, for example, we have a lot of factories over here, but based on low labor cost. It's not automation yet, it's not a technology shift yet. So we're talking about probably a second generation going to the third. But the good news is, you can always leapfrog to fourth. You don't have to experience second and third, because the fourth industrial generation is, again, is invented by those countries who have experienced all these steps. But this is a chance for this region that you skip all these, make a lot of investment in IT, AI, to change. But that creates another problem. It's the labor issues, because that eliminates labor. So we need social ecosystem to be prepared for that. But this region has a huge opportunity that can be done effectively.
The question really is, this is probably for you, Ulf, how do you leapfrog? How can ASEAN economies leapfrog? And I'll come to Nazir and Shahril, how your own companies are reinventing to ride this fourth industrial revolution. Maybe Ulf, you can start the ball rolling.
Well, I think the obvious answer to the leapfrogging is that a lot of the ICT technology gives you possibilities to do things in completely new ways. So value chains all over the world are disrupted by all kinds of ICT technology. I think the obvious answers are Uber on a global base, perhaps Gojek if you would go to Indonesia. Same thing, but disrupting a value chain by using ICT technology. I think there are several other very good examples out here in a very, very scattered, if you look at the online communities out in Southeast Asia, it's a very scattered picture with lots of local brands and local platforms being mixed with global brands and global platforms. And all of those are, in fact, leapfrogging by using ICT technology to solve problems. So I think this is a very good example where Asia is already benefiting from it, but it will benefit even more in the future as the economy and the economic growth here is very strong with a large population, a very large young population.
Nazir, how has it changed the business or how the business is done?
Well, we're a bank. We already got bashed up post the global financial crisis. Now we're being bashed up by or challenged by fintech, and we have to respond to that. And I think it's still early days. Fintech is chipping away at different parts of banking, and banks have to respond. I keep telling my guys, I said, look, you know, in another capacity, we invest in many disruptive technologies. And these guys come up with business plans where they say, you know, invest a huge amount of money, and we promise we'll start making profits in 10 years' time, right? And they're getting money. On the other hand, when I look at my different departments, I ask them to invest in new technology and have 2 years of losses, and they'll get scared because their annual profits will be affected. So, you know, for us, an old economy company, to make that transition is tough, but it has to be done. I think we need to think like the fintechs, be a fintech ourselves, and be innovative. And I think this sort of, you know, I suppose it's a sort of fight back of the empire, if you like, will come. It's a bit like taxis and Uber. I think the answer is for taxis not to demonstrate against Uber, but to actually develop technology to compete with Uber. You already have your numbers.
Shahril, oil and gas.
Well,
you've had...
You were saying?
No, I was going to say, you've been forced to relook at how business is done. I mean, given where oil is, I mean, you've had to look at the cost-effective way of running the business.
Definitely. And our philosophy internally is it's not new. As we better destroy ourselves before somebody else destroys us. So we look at the way we execute and how we develop solutions for our customers and adopt disruptive technologies in order to make our value proposition attractive. A simple example is going from shallow water to deep water. We say, let's invest in deep water. And in order to do that, we don't use divers anymore. We had to go out and acquire technology in ROVs. We had to change in the way we execute and the materials that we use. And by doing that, we were able to penetrate the Brazilian market. And that now becomes more than half of our volume of work. And it's the same with every segment of our other businesses. I think we need to look at how to adopt disruptive technologies and how that actually changes the execution of your work and your value proposition to your customers. And it's even more rapid when you go into ICT and kind of work we do in secured communications, where it's a continuous change and continuously having to disrupt your own models. I think that's the way we look at it and how we adopt technology in order to address the ever-changing marketplace. Mm. And one more thing I would like to add when you talk about the fourth industrial revolution, we also have to look forward, that when this new paradigm comes in, there will also be a new paradigm of supporting industries that support this new paradigm. And that presents an opportunity for this young population to come in, as Mr. Fujimori said, to leapfrog and be in supporting industries. An example I would use is robotics and prosthetics. In order to support that industry of mechanical leg, they need to have a supporting industries of technicians, engineers, maintenance units all over the world, having to adopt wireless technology to continuously upgrade your robotic leg. Yeah, that is a totally new paradigm where opportunities for the population of ASEAN, this young population, to subscribe to and totally create a new industry. Not only that would be an intra-ASEAN trade, but also something that is viable and a value proposition for the rest of the communities globally. So I think the future is bright.
The future is bright. GE has said that intelligent machines will add $10 to $15 trillion to the global economy. From your perspective, Ibumari, is there a model out there that, you know, among ASEAN nations, who's on the right track? Who's doing the right thing?
Let me take a kind of a policymaker's perspective from this discussion. I think we want disruptive technology or creative destruction. We don't want destructive technologies. I think that's kind of the real worry, the dark side of it. And so how should countries or ASEAN respond to it? We can leapfrog, but we can also get stuck in second or third phase or get left behind, right? And all the studies show that the digital dividend is not there. It's actually widening the inequality between those who cannot just access but use it, and those who don't have the access. Or sometimes you have the access, but you don't know how to use it, right? So the challenge, first of all, I think we have to anticipate. It's not right now, but it's going to happen in the next few years, and it's going to happen very fast. So policy response, hard infrastructure. So you have to have the telecommunications infrastructure, you have to have the broadband and so on, you have to have the access. Then you need the soft infrastructure. The access or the technology, whether it's the digital or the robotics technology, technology is a means to an end, right? You have the people. People are still important. So you have to have the education training for the people to know how to use the technology to their advantage. And technology is a powerful tool for reducing inequity. So for banks, with branchless banking and mobile banking, that is financial inclusion. E-commerce, you are reaching out where their stores are not there, right? Things like that. And then regulation, right? Because governments and regulators actually do not have any idea what is happening, they tend to over-regulate and control in the old way. So this is really, I think, a lot of debates in each of our countries in ASEAN. I think Thailand just ban Uber? I think Indonesia has its problems with Uber. Everybody, Uber as a good example because it's affecting all of us and we're responding in different ways. I agree that it's the old companies, old traditional business companies have to respond, and they have, right? 5 years ago, New York taxi drivers are still rude, right? Today, they're not rude anymore because they've had to compete with Uber, for instance. It will happen.
Is there a right response? You talk about
I don't think there's a right response. There's not one size fits all. It depends very much. It's country specific, but it's very political because you do have to pay attention to the negative side and the transition mechanism. How do you have a smooth transition? Probably there's no smooth transition, but you do have to anticipate and not overreact. I think a lot of governments, despite learning from others, have responded, I think, not in the right way. So I think the regulation has to focus on the security aspects, the level playing field on competition, on payment of taxes and so on. And most importantly, I think we have to focus on making sure our human capital is trained and able. It's not just the skill, right? Because the skill that you need today may be very different from even a year from now. So it's the ability to adapt and be able to be flexible and respond to the very rapid changes. And it's not just a skill thing, apparently. According to, I think, the World Economic Forum Future of Jobs, one of the skill sets that are needed for today's labor force is EQ, emotional quotient. And it's never there before, it's now there. It really is the ability for you to be persistent and not give up when you have all these rapid changes happening around you. And that, I think, so the human capital is probably a priority issue.
Nazir, you wanted to add?
I would agree with what Ibu said, but a couple of points. One is, there is no such thing as a one-size-fits-all the response, but there's also a wrong response.
Yeah.
Right? Which is to kill the challenges. And that's what I mentioned earlier about this, the threat of vested interests and big corporations collaborating with political powers. I think that's a big risk in this region, and I cannot amplify that more. Second point is, I think what comes with this is actually an opportunity in education, a revolution in education. I think we really, in this region, need to think about how we educate the population. Of course, the young ones, but also the old ones, right? How do we re-educate? And if we have driverless cars, how do we prepare the out-of-job drivers today? And what is the education infrastructure to transition all those people?
Fuji, your take?
Yeah, in terms of, I just want to touch the skill and the education part of it. Currently, Japan and probably the third industrial revolution has been driven by mechanical and electrical engineering. What is driving force in the computer science and digital engineering. Now, looking at the numbers of computer science in the United States, about 300,000 computer science generating every year. China maybe said millions, and India said 2 million. Not sure the aggregated ASEAN countries, how many computer science technology and how many schools are good at computer science, but if the fourth industrial generation or the future is developed by those different skills, you're right, absolutely, we have to invest in those people. This is not just here in this region, but for Japan as well and for other countries as well. So education is very important. But at the same time, it's a long term. You invest in computer science right now, that becomes powerful probably 10 years from now, 15 years from now. Maybe you're late. So getting the people from intellectual capital from outside, be part of the member. You don't have to be an agent for Asia. You can have a lot of people to come in this region. So this region has to be attractive. Attractive for the foreign direct investment, attractive for those people to come in and to make something else. So you can do the short-term solution by generating, for example, in this region or the country by country, for example, the huge venture capital fund or strong, huge incentive for those people to come in or use those young millennials to really do something to encourage and to give some chances to them. And that could be a short-term solutions, I think.
So let's look at the millennials, because they're the ones who will be the future consumers. They're the ones who will be driving the economy. How do we engage them, ensure they have the kind of jobs that will be created in the future? We talk about education. What kind of education? What should we be looking at?
I believe the base is connectivity. I think it's imperative that we allocate and invest connectivity for our future generation. Why I say this? If you look at the work that's being done by universities today in e-learning, it is actually remarkable. Those individuals out there, if they can get connectivity, they can get educated in free internet access, yeah, to free courses, even at places like MIT or Harvard now, where they are offering courses for free in order to get a degree. Yeah? So the learning and education of millennials themselves is going to change once you put that connectivity in. And the fact that the reality is, these kids that are coming up, growing up today, they are already connected. They're already collaborators. They collaborate in the way they work, they collaborate in their social life, they collaborate when they study, and for sure, now they even collaborate when they play games across the world. So naturally, these millennials are going to develop new business models out there that is going to be very, 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 very good for the area. Just pick up the point, it doesn't have to be technologies from ASEAN. These technologies become commodity when people talk to people. They can then use those technologies to develop business models in ASEAN, using ASEAN's relative strength in order to be good partners to the rest of the communities in the world. I think this is what we have to keep in mind about the millennials. I have lots of hope for the coming generation in this area.
Ulf, paint the picture for us. What's going to be possible in the future that we're not even thinking of today?
If you think about what's really going on, is that we're living in the time where business would never have more knowledge about their customers than now. And we're living at a time where actually the pace of change is very slow, so we can enjoy the moment because it's just going to change faster. And that means that for any business, you can use analytics technology, you can use big data and data mining to know exactly where a consumer is, or how in a B2B relationship exactly where goods is, or where any part of the value chain is moving. And that's all happening first on-premise in the company in itself, but most and most is moving into cloud, where it's combined with other knowledge that other companies make in the same cloud. Now, as those knowledges are being interactive to a higher and higher degree, you could say that the knowledge capital of industry and business is moving into cloud or data centers to a very large degree. And as that is happening, it puts all demands on connectivity, just like what you said, because clouds are no use if they're not connected. And the clouds are no use if they're not connected to data points out in the field, smartphones being one of the biggest, but you mentioned before Internet of Things, which is even bigger. The global prediction of Internet of Things growth will grow to around 30 billion devices or connected machines in the year 2020, global perspective. And that's compared then to, at the same time, around 6 billion mobile subscribers. As you can see that the size, the Internet of Things and the machines is much bigger. And the reason why that's happening is actually because processor technology is moving in such a rapid pace, it becomes very, very cost efficient and can be built into anything. And we see it already in process. And all those processors is going to be connected. And that gives totally new business opportunities to those clouds, which were building all that knowledge, which is really the biggest transformation factors. And I guess my point is that I think for Southeast Asia, and if I'm comparing to the debate we've had in Europe, and I would like to pick up on what Ibu Pangestu said before about Indonesia here, that regulators are far behind, and when they go in, they often overregulate this, particularly in an old traditional way, in silos, which was mentioned here before, you know, looking at only one part of government, going after what they think is important, and another part going after what they... We've had all those things happening in Europe, and I think Asia certainly, or Southeast Asia, has a lot to learn from the collaboration and the discussion climate and look at what others are doing wrong. For instance, we have just passed a new regulation on privacy of information in Europe, which has consequences, quite big consequences in terms of how data analytics can be used and how information can be used to further promote business and so forth. And then there is all the regulatory environment in the United States, which is also perhaps the most advanced market, or is the most advanced market, when it comes to cloud and when it comes to broadband connectivity and so on. So all these factors together really encourages and underpins a climate of collaboration between government and the businesses in a whole region. And I think now we're here at the World Economic Forum in Kuala Lumpur, but I think even more discussions like this. I participated in a regulatory forum that was invited by the regulator in Singapore on Monday, which was all about these issues. And then I've not even added the dark side, which was mentioned here, which is all cybercrime and what overreactions it can lead to, but also the extreme importance of addressing the right issues when it comes to the dark side.
So do you agree, Nazir, Ibu Mari, that governments and companies can work together to reduce regulation?
I'm not in government anymore, but I will. I think they have to, because and not just governments and companies, but governments and the whole, consumer society and so on, because things are moving so fast that I think governments have a tendency to want to control, especially when there's a negative reaction, when there's a negative outcome of the so-called dark side. So I think governments have to tread lightly. I think that's what I've heard in many conversations. They have to tread lightly. They have to be very, very engaged and get input from all the businesses as to where things are going and what needs to be regulated. And I think it's more about ensuring security and safety, level playing field, paying taxes and so on. And, protecting the consumers as well as the so-called workers, if you like, who are participating in this shared economy, because even in the US, they're having this debate now about whether Uber drivers who are self-employed need to be protected, things like that. So I think this is a big debate going forward where we don't, I think policymakers do not know where this is going, so it's better to tread lightly, but to be conscious of it and to actually be more anticipatory to see where it's going. And I think reducing the dark side or the negative side or the inequalities of this whole process is really about education and training, right? And the ability for all of us, I think the regulators actually also have to be educated in a way to know what is going on. This is real world. Robotics is not something of the future. It's already happening. I mean, I just recently I have seen a number of Indonesian companies that have already migrated to using robotics, and it is about competition and so on. But it doesn't mean you're replacing labor. It means your labor has to go from unskilled, semi-skilled to a higher skill. They're operating systems. They're not just on the assembly line anymore. So that anticipation, I think we still have time, that anticipation has to start today. And that has to be in our education system, the way we train, and probably incentivize also companies as well as human capital to undertake this change. And if you go back to the World Economic Forum Future of Jobs study, creativity was number 10 in the ranking of skills needed. Now it's number 3. And emotional quotient, as I said, was not existing before. Now it's there. And part of it is what you were saying earlier, collaboration. It's no longer individual work. You're being rated, or that your company is being rated based on that individual performance indicator anymore, because it's a sharing economy. You have to collaborate. You have to communicate. So that's also a different skill set that's needed.
Yeah, I let Ibu go first, and she's taken all my points. But let me just add that this collaboration between government and private sector, this is one of the reasons why ASEAN is not moving at pace. ASEAN governments are reluctant, I think, to listen to the right voices in the private sector. They have a business advisory council, and that those are appointed business people, rather than getting businesses to select the right voices. So I just get a bit frustrated that some of the policies, et cetera, that have evolved with bringing down tariff barriers in ASEAN have not been formulated with the full input of the private sector. The good news is that under the 2025 blueprint, there is a commitment to engage the private sector more, but in that context overall, I still am waiting for the full details in terms of how the 2025 blueprint would actually be implemented.
Can I just add one more point? I think there's, in this sharing economy, just because everything is open and connected, there's a lot of self-regulation going on because customers are rating vendors. In peer-to-peer lending, you have a private, I guess, credit bureau emerging. So, you know, it doesn't just have to be government.
The business and the government has been always discussing, and most of the discussion has been on regulation and deregulation, because the business want more open environment. And I think this ASEAN or the total region has to open up more. Japan had the last 5 years went into the discussion on TPP, the Trans-Pacific Agreement. And that's the concept of opening up. That means we go more globalization, we accept globalization to come in. And that really raises the issue of the protected industry, like agriculture. But the theory of the case is the more you protect it, the more you subsidize, you lose your competitiveness in the world. So the TPP actually, we believe, and we have a lot of debate about this deregulation, non-tariff barriers, but the more you open up, the more you face yourself into the global competitiveness, but that strengthens yourself. And this region, I think you need the concept of more opening up, more accepting globalization. So in the sense that we accept many countries, like currently the Singapore, Vietnam, Brunei are in TPP, but if all of ASEAN comes into TPP or create our separate second stage, I think it's create huge economy here, but at the same time it's open economy as well as globalized economy. That really itself encourages the people to be more proactive for the innovation.
On that note, I'd like to open the discussion to the floor. If there are questions, if you could raise your hand. Someone with a microphone will be coming your way. If there's any question from the floor. See one over there?
Hi there. It was very interesting listening to your conversation. Maybe keying off Mr. Razak's frustration, if I close my eyes and ignore the date of this conversation, it seems to me we could have been having the same conversation 10 years ago. And that all the issues you've raised, whether it's the vested interests, the siloed behavior, the optimism around youth, we've known that for a long time. How optimistic are you really that in 10 years' time we'll be having a different conversation?
Would you like to take that question, Ezra?
Oh, sure. No, I think that, well, I don't think it's wholly true that nothing has happened over the 10 years. I think, you know, even if you look at my industry, we have evolved the qualified ASEAN banking framework. It should be much more comprehensive and more detailed, etc. But at least it's there, it's progress. I think in various other sectors also, tariff barriers have been completely wiped out and so on and so forth. So ASEAN has made progress, but certainly, as I said earlier, not to the extent that I wanted or they promised. I think if you look out 10 years, I will take the fifth on that because I have yet to see the implementation blueprint for 2025. I actually think that we're not going to get very far unless there is greater empowerment of the ASEAN Secretariat. And we don't see that. I think the ASEAN Secretariat budget is still $17 million a year. EU is like £150 billion or something. So unless we have leadership to actually deal full-time with critical issues about integration, I think progress will be quite slow. Yeah, so I think that is, I think, the key indicator of where we will be in 10 years, and that's coming in the next few months.
The most optimistic voice comes from Shahril, so let's get Shahril to answer that question.
I believe industry must lead. Industry must show the benefits of collaboration and must show the benefits of deregulation, but at the same time, industry must understand why those regulations are there, so that they can actually go and convince why a certain initiative is good, certain forms of deregulation is good. Those regulations are there for a reason. And the reason is to protect the atom itself, which is the people. So unless you show, industry shows, whatever initiatives that they do benefits the individual, it's going to be difficult for the government to just simply go out and let it go.
But 10 years from now, will we have a different conversation?
Yes, we will. We will, because for example, we're already starting to see cross-border development of resources and how that benefits the parties involved in terms of industry, in terms of jobs, in terms of technology being brought in. The model that we use is wherever we go to develop resource, we use indigenous capabilities to build those resources, whether it's a pipeline, whether it's an oil field. So in that way, regulations come down, they allow us to bring in expertise from outside, expertise that we ensure would come and develop indigenous people like we do in Brazil, like we do in Mexico, like we do in Africa. Yeah, then they start to relax, they understand, okay, you're not just here bringing in your economic power and not developing the capabilities of those individuals. We do it in Indonesia, we do it in Thailand. So, and we can see this collaboration coming together, and it's working very well. I think we will have a different conversation. Plus, coming back to the fact that in this fourth industrial revolution, when it comes to the Internet of Things, the reality is regulation is going to take a back seat. It's going to happen. It's going to happen. So what will happen there would be self-regulation. And a business model will only work across borders if it benefits the individual, in both ways, as an individual and as a customer. So I feel it'll be self-regulating, and I still am very optimistic that you would see it.
We'll let Nazir rebut first.
Sorry, I'm not going to rebut Shahril, because...
because I owe him a lot of money, he's afraid I won't pay him.
But I just wanted to make the point that tomorrow here, we'll have a discussion about setting up a WEF platform on ASEAN. And I think it's about bringing together businesses to leverage on the experience and capabilities of WEF to influence the whole ASEAN integration process. And you know, same point Shahril is making, so that business can actually move on irrespective to some extent of what government does.
Yeah, I just wanted to comment from the global perspective that how different was it 20 years ago, Japan, USA, Europe, actually the same way. The smartphones and Internet of Things has changed our lives totally different, which we couldn't even see 20 years ago. Now, I think this region is not the exception of that. When you look for the next 10 years, the slowness or the pace that we experienced for the last 20 years or last 50 years is totally different from next 10 years. Again, that's what happened in a global arena, and I think that's going to happen in this region as well, because globally, there's a borderless environment right now, and again, this is not an isolated region, this is a part of the globe.
I think we will have a different conversation, definitely, and I'm also on the optimist side of what's happening here. A couple of key indicators. One key indicator that if you look at online behavior, Southeast Asia is stronger than the rest of the world. And in terms of population and number of users and people willing to go online, willing to do things online. I think that's one very important point. The other point is that the infrastructure investments in this part of the world, when I'm looking at telecoms, is more optimistic than many other parts without going into specifics, but there are slowdowns in different parts of the world. But here it is very optimistic. So if you look at the service providers and the operators of infrastructure, digital infrastructure, it's a quite optimistic view of what's going on. They also hold some of the key assets in terms of transforming the economies here, which has to do with identity, things about financial inclusion possibilities with so much prepaid, for example, in this part of the world. And then you have the whole youth coming with it. And then you have the growth of all the industries here, which needs to digitalize and transform. And I completely agree with the comment that Internet of Things will happen without there. It's already happening. It's happening all around us. And the cars that are in this region will, from the beginning, be connected to a very large degree. So I think in that sense, I'm also a big optimist and looking forward to all the changes that's going to happen here.
I'm an optimist also, because I think it should be the millennials who will be governing us in 10 years' time. So whatever happens, whatever, despite or in spite of what the government tries to do, we're already going to be integrated. So the governments have to catch up in policy. Second, nobody mentioned about politics and governance. I think the whole way of elections and the way government officials are being elected or government leaders are being elected has totally changed. And it's the millennials, it's the interconnectivity. You know, President Jokowi, President Modi are examples of how social media and millennials have really got them into where they are now. There is a danger of being like populist policies, but I think at the end, the millennials, with their value system and very critical, they will be, I think, a good force for governance, which is also, for me, another source of optimism.
We'll take one quick question. Before, there's nobody there. Okay, we'll take it from that gentleman over there.
Hi, good morning. My name is Zainal, Invest KL. Welcome everyone to KL. My question to the panel is this. Moving forward in years to come, are you going to have the same number of people in your organizations but get them to do more, or are you going to have less people apply technology and do more?
Good question.
I can say probably more, because we're not just talking about manufacturing. I believe that the manufacturing and services and related customer-focused solutions are going to be a business model in the future. So it is true that with automation technology shift, we need, not necessarily need, but we have less people in manufacturing side, but we educate them, we train them, so they can be a more value-added service and total solution for this region or for the world. So I think net-net, we create more values with those people, but we need to train them, we need to educate them to have different skills.
But there are reports out there suggesting that with disruptive technology, 40% of workers will be displaced globally.
But the new industry is coming up.
Yeah.
But what I believe is less people will do more in our companies of the future, but there will be more companies servicing a bigger segments of industries that we don't see today. I think you would see one individual, maybe in the very distant future, that individual would be working for multiple businesses rather than just one.
I think you'll have less people working in the more routine work and less quality work, and you'll have more people working in better quality work, and that's a good thing, right? Better quality, higher wages, and more skill. So that's why the anticipation needs to happen starting now, and you have to look at it in like a medium term. You can't look at it as a point of today, you know.
I think maybe if you look at Ericsson in this part of the world. I think manufacturing for us is a very small part. We actually have only two factories left in the world, one in Nanjing and one in Europe. And the value add, if you look at it, telecom products, is on the manufacturing side from labor is only 2%. So it's a very, very small part. Still, when we are meeting with governments here, also out in the region, the first question is, are you going to put a factory in my country? Are you going to put manufacturing here? And I'm always replying that what we would like to do is to put a software center here and put software skills to place and perhaps build cloud infrastructure and start to work with the knowledge part of building the economy instead. And I think that's back to policymaking. That's going to be an extremely important factor for the region here to put incentives in place that many other countries, like Canada, for example, has very big incentives for moving software development and these kind of skills into the region. So I think that those are the more, so to answer the question, if we're going to grow, we're going to grow because software is very labor intensive still. There's lots of technologies to make it less labor intensive, but knowledge workers and software development is going to grow us out in this part of the world.
On that note, I'd like to wrap up today's discussion. I'd like each panelist to give the key takeaway from today's chat. And if I could start with Shahril, we'll go down the line.
I think I firmly believe that industry needs to lead and that the next generation will change the face of industry in ASEAN and the need to collaborate between businesses to find harnessing projects to demonstrate that this has got a lot of benefits. And that will bring the barriers down when benefits are clear, when regulations are taken off.
Ulf?
Key takeaways, learnings from the comments on the panel, I think is really the what everybody comes back to is the collaboration, the discussion between countries and how to embrace this enormous change that the fourth industrial revolution really, really means. Another key takeaway is, of course, from my perspective, the connectivity and the meaning of connectivity to embrace those who are not yet embraced, but also to be able to supply much better connectivity to companies that wants to lead and wants to move forward and inspire the change in the region.
Fuji?
This region has a bright future. And that future is driven by those millennials. So I have a great hope this region. But at the same time, I think there's a role the government has to play. And that's what I call One Asia, ASEAN. Because it has to be an attractive market for the people to invest, for people to come. And that requires a common system, common architecture, common connectivity, whatever, that attracts the people to come in. And that's what the government can do together, of course, with the industries.
Ibu Mari?
I'm an optimist and I'm an ASEANist. I believe in ASEAN, and I believe ASEAN has great prospects. We are the seventh largest economy in the world, if you take us as a whole. 40% of our population, I think 50% of our population below 29, probably 40% are millennials. So the important role is for government to facilitate, create a conducive environment, tread lightly where you don't know where things are going, and take a holistic and comprehensive approach to policy making. You can't do it in silos anymore, both nationally as well as in ASEAN.
Nazir.
Well, I'm a bit battered and bruised by, the work we've done in ASEAN, integrating ASEAN, building a business across ASEAN, and the pushback over the years. I think I'm optimistic about technology, what it brings, but it brings a lot of change. And that change, I think, will bring challenges and it's going to be bumpy. So what is critical is how the governments respond and how they encourage us to realize our great potential as opposed to becoming defensive and too protective. I think that's the critical decision factor.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sure you'll agree with me that it's been pretty insightful. We'll come back in 10 years to decide if the conversation remains old. Thank you.